What kind of beer do you like? Heineken. Heineken? Fuck that shit! Pabst Blue Ribbon!
Yeah.
Great. Wait, we're really streaming? Are you sure?
I'm 59% sure.
Yay! Hi, everybody. Welcome.
Yeah, that is on.
Great. Welcome, welcome. You'll notice an empty chair right here. Jay will be here later.
All right, I'm going to play Brutal Doom.
And Rich is going to play Brutal Doom because we figured we needed something a little mindless. Something a little mindless while we chatted about things and stuff and crap and all that fun stuff. I did try to find, just before we started streaming, I did try to find a tiny, tiny skeleton.
Oh!
From the Halloween episode of Best of the Worst, but I didn't, I couldn't find it. So, I was hoping to have a tiny skeleton here to DJ, but there you go. Is the Doom face right next to my face? So it's like Jay's here. Welcome, Doom
it's
Guy.
A special guest.
Doom Guy. Oh, you guys want to talk about Supergirl? Supergirl is a fucking hot mess of a show. It is really, really bad. Really, really bad.
Are you still the only one who hates it?
I've seen many people really enjoy Supergirl, and I think that's really weird.
They think you're really weird.
Exactly. I don't understand why people like it so much. It's all over the place. Here's an example, because I watched the second episode. You know, you can't judge. Not every show you can judge by its first episode, right? So here's by the way, some mild spoilers for the first and second episode of Supergirl. So the backstory is this: Supergirl is a preteen when she leaves Krypton, and she is actually shipped off with Kal-El to protect him. But while Kal-El makes it to Earth, Kara gets trapped in the Phantom Zone. And so, you know, Kal-El comes to Earth and becomes Superman, all while Kara doesn't age in the Phantom Zone. So then she comes to Earth and Superman already exists, and she just gets to lead her own life, right? And she decides to become Supergirl later on. So the second episode, she is kind of like figuring out what it takes to be a hero and whatnot, and she meets up with her aunt. And her aunt is a bad guy, and we know her aunt is a bad guy because we see her aunt be a bad guy. But
her aunt?
Her aunt.
Like Kryptonian aunt?
Her Kryptonian aunt shows up because in the Phantom Zone, the prison that was in the Phantom Zone also came through when Kara... It's a whole... Don't even worry.
Okay.
Her aunt is a bad guy, right?
I think there's just too many fucking Kryptonians already.
There's... by the way, yeah, there's three already. At least. No, there's five already. So, her aunt comes back, and we know her aunt is a bad guy, but she doesn't know her aunt is a bad guy. In fact, she remembers her aunt really fondly. And she sees her aunt, and she's like, "What are you doing here, aunt?" And the aunt is like, I got trapped in the prison because I tried to save Krypton, and they didn't believe me. And now I need to save Earth. Will you help me save Earth, Supergirl?"
Okay.
And so, what do we know about Krypton?
It blows up.
It blows up. And so, she tried to save Krypton. And immediately, Supergirl goes, "I will fight you."
What?
Immediately, Supergirl says, "I will fight you for that."
For saving Earth?
Yes. For no reason.
I have to take your word on all of this.
Right. Phantom Zone equals the Nexus. Anyway. So she starts fighting her evil aunt because her aunt said that she wanted to save the Earth and she wasn't able to save Krypton. We already know the aunt is a bad guy because we see her be a bad guy, but Supergirl doesn't see that. It makes no sense.
But whatever, I don't give a fuck. It's all fine. It's fine.
Right? You shouldn't. It's not a good show, so you shouldn't give a fuck. But it's like, it's one of those things where... I was trying to, you know, cite a specific example of why it doesn't make any sense and why I don't like it. I just don't understand why other people like it. So, you know what I've been crazy getting into while I've been doing a bunch of special effects work? I've been binge watching Arrow and The Flash. And I'm super into both of them now.
I don't think that's it.
That's not making much difference.
Well, that's the backlight. That's not the
right thing.
Brightness. There you go. So the Arrow and the
That's much better.
The Arrow and the Flash are great. The Flash in particular. And I don't give a shit about the Flash, like as a superhero. But that's a good show. I like that. Flash.
I find it helpful when you can see what you're shooting at.
Yes.
Yep.
I agree. I thought Arrow was bad. Arrow is cheesy. Arrow is really cheesy.
How can you avoid cheesy when you're making a show about a guy who fights crime with a bow and arrow?
Exactly. But they did not blend the cheese well. You know, like, it was very cheesy and overly dramatic at the same time. And it didn't blend well.
Cheese is your destiny at that point.
Actually, the thing that helped me get back into the Arrow was watching The Flash. Because, you know, they're in the same universe and they actually interact quite often, the Arrow and Flash, in each other's episodes. And so, like, The Flash nails their tone. You know, like, they understand that they are a goofy show about a man wearing red tights. And I think that kind of helped me figure out the Arrow's tone, or they settle down a little bit, but I've been super into them. Super, super into Arrow and Flash. Does the Arrow get better after the pilot? Nah. It's the same. It's the same. It's not great. Here's what I'll say about the Arrow is you get used to it. You conform to its particular brand of cheese.
Ooh, we're just falling around.
Kick him. Kick that 2D sprite.
I did. That was glorious.
Arrow is not a great character, and, I mean, literally all it is they're trying to do Batman.
Well, that's all the Arrow ever was.
Oh, no, slight spoiler alert coming up for Arrow Season 3. The entirety of Arrow Season 3 deals with Ra's al Ghul wanting him to take over the League of League of Assassins.
What?
Yes. Literally an exact Batman one.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
That's awful.
Yeah. And the first season of The Arrow is about someone trying to take over Starling City because it's overrun with poverty by killing all the impoverished people and starting over from scratch, just like in Batman Begins.
Okay.
So they've gone beyond trying, like, being like a low-grade Batman. They're just like, we're going to take all the Batman stories and just give them to the Arrow because we don't have a Batman TV show.
Can I stick with Batman the Animated Series?
You can.
For my DC content?
Of course you can.
A little bit of Justice League?
A little bit of Justice League. You know what? I even like The Adventures of Superman. That was a good show. That was fun.
The DC Animated Superman? Or
which? Yeah.
Okay.
The one in the same universe as Batman, the Animated Series.
I think that was just called Superman.
I thought it was The Adventures of Superman.
I think that's something else. I think that's the 50s show.
I don't know. You know what? How about that? Have you watched Gotham? I watched a couple episodes of Gotham and didn't much care for it. But
Gotham's fine.
It's fine.
I caught the first half of season one.
Yeah.
I liked it.
Yeah.
I'm not in love with it. I'm not going to marry it.
Only the first half of season one, obviously. So not so much into it that you had to watch more of it.
Well, that was when the season break happened and whatever. For no particularly great reason, I didn't catch back up. Mm-hmm.
You know, Professor Pun, what are your thoughts on people wanting spoilers before a movie even comes out? It's kind of the nature of the internet, which kind of speeds everything up.
You know what?
What?
Mass Effect 3 caused me to do that with games. If I know a game's gonna be, like, heavy on story, I'm gonna read up on whether or not the ending is shit before I get invested.
That's terrible.
That's Mass Effect 3's doing. Not mine. Thank you, BioWare.
That is terrible.
Thank you, BioWare.
You know, but it's one of those things where, like, behind the scenes footage used to be a fun treat, and people discovered very early that that could be used to help market a movie, right? Is leaking out information, but now that has snowballed, and so now they're strategically leaking stuff and making sure that they're leaking stuff on a regular schedule, and in order to release new information about the movie on a regular schedule, they need to give more and more of the movie away in smaller chunks, and that's just how it's going. That's just what's happening. So the only people we have to blame for this are ourselves. If you have ever clicked on a story about breaking down the new poster for Star Wars and what we think is going to happen, if you ever like clicked on a web video that was just like two guys talking about the new Star Wars movie and what they think about it, then you are to blame. Then you are to blame for this culture of more information, speculative information.
Just avoid the information.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. Interview people from the Order 1886. Yeah, I think that's one of those things where, you know, we would set up that interview and then they might look into us and see that interview and then cancel. So.
How big of jagoffs do you suppose they would be? How pretentious are the creators of the Order?
Oh, and see, I wouldn't see it like that. Everything I've seen about them interview-wise came out before the game was released.
Fuck.
And, you know, then you're in marketing mode and you kind of have to talk nice about the project. I think there's a...
Just having created that in the first place, how pretentious do you suppose they are?
There's a possibility. I would also give the possibility that they completely understand what they made wasn't good and, you know, had a couple deadlines and had some expectations from Sony. Whether or not they'd be able to talk about that in an interview is a whole other thing, because, you know, they have their own relationships and businesses to...
You'd never get a candid interview out of them.
No, oh God, no. Not unless they've made a separate game for a separate company that was big, and they could trash Sony.
Or their career was just over already.
Exactly.
And they have nothing to lose.
Like, you know, they're on their camel farm or whatever it is, and... or corn farm, you know. Camel farm is just the first thing I thought of. Or their lobster farm. Maybe they run a lobster farm. Is there such a thing as a lobster farm? Suppose we need to get lobster anyway. How do you get lobster? Like, I know it comes from the sea, but do you call it a lobster farm?
No. This farm raised, like, fish.
Yeah.
I can only assume this farm raised lobster. Yes. Though, lobster are probably easy enough to catch that they don't need a farm. You put a cage in the water and you lift the cage up and there's like 8,000 lobsters in the cage.
But the area in which you keep all of your lobster cages...
Oh my god. Oh my god.
What did you do?
Nothing. I'm just moving the mic.
Is that called a lobster farm?
No.
Or is it just called the ocean?
If you're catching wild lobsters, no, it's not called
it's just
lobster.
The ocean.
It's just called the ocean? I don't know anything about lobster farming.
So before I got here, was there just a big empty space?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
We didn't want to have to deal with, like...
Having to adjust it or anything?
Having to adjust the camera. Or anything. Yeah. I tried to find the tiny skeleton.
Rich, I think you cleaned up last time.
You know what? I probably put it in one of those bins.
Oh, okay, I gotta take that home with me, because that's my personal tiny skeleton.
Oh my god, I did not
that
know
that. That is not a studio prop. And I wanted to get one anyway, and it was just advantageous that it was around Halloween time, where you could easily get one.
Sure.
I just decided one day that I didn't have one, and I needed one.
Needed.
They have great skeletons at Walmart. Full size articulated skeletons.
Oh sure, do they still have them? They might have them on clearance. That'd
they might
be great.
Have them on clearance. It was like $20. It was relatively cheap.
Maybe I'll check that out.
Like, they had no good skeletons at the Halloween stores.
Oh yeah.
all their
skeletons. Yeah, sometimes they have like certain things that are really great and then other things that are no good at all.
Yep. And then we just happened to like hop into Walmart for something else and just sit in there. It was a perfect skeleton.
Well, that's great.
Great. It was great.
For the studio every year, I buy the monster cereals. And it's like, well, they're here. I gotta keep eating it.
Right?
It's the only time of the year I eat cereal.
Frankenberry never lasts long. Yeah. That's the shit.
Do they actually taste different?
Yeah.
Yeah!
Frankenberries,
strawberry.
Strawberry.
Okay.
Blueberries, blueberry. And then Count Chocula is chocolate. I don't know what the difference between Frankenberry and like Fruit Brute is. Maybe Fruit Brute's like a mixed one, but that doesn't come out every year anyway. That's a rarer one. There's also Yummy Mummy.
What?
Those are the.
What's the difference between Yummy Mummy and Fruit Brute?
I have no idea.
The same thing with a different branding.
I don't know if I've ever had either, because there's the three staples that they do every year, and then every once in a while they'll re-release like Fruit Brute or Yummy Mummy.
I've never even heard of those. That's how rare.
Yeah, they're not that common.
Now I want some Yummy Mummy.
No, you don't, because mummies suck.
Oh,
I hate mummies. They're the worst monsters.
They just haven't been done right.
Jay, don't. Shh.
No, we're going to reinvent the mummy someday.
That's what I'm
saying. We'll make mummies cool.
Mummies just haven't gotten their remade respect yet.
Yes.
Which
someday
we will get to work on.
Someday some filmmaker will come along, the right filmmaker, and make mummies cool.
Because
as it stands right now, mummies suck.
Pretty much.
They're the lamest.
They made an attempt to reinvent the mummy. But then they made their movie star Brandon Fraser.
And they basically made an Indiana Jones movie.
Exactly.
Without Indiana Jones and with mummies.
And with mummies. And that's dumb.
In one of Lloyd Kaufman's books, the head of trauma, he described mummies as that kid in high school that you steal his glasses and throw them over his head to your friends.
Aww.
That's what a mummy is. A slow, lumbering, worthless monster.
Poor mummies. No respect.
I don't feel bad for them.
You don't feel? I feel bad for mummies. They're a hard-working monster. They're out there cursing people, maybe. I don't know what mummies. They curse people, right?
They just shuffle around. They suck.
But they curse you. That's the mummies thing. The mummies curse.
Yeah. Whatever. What am I more terrified of, a curse or getting my fucking head bitten off?
Ooh, okay. All right. Got it.
What if it's a mummy with a really big mouth? I'm gonna bite your head off.
Ooh.
They're too weak, though. They walk slowly up to you, and you just run away.
They're slow, but I think they are supposed to be strong. I think mummy strength
is... If they're
is
slow,
thing.
It doesn't matter. You just run away. It's like Chucky. Chucky's coming towards you. You just kick him.
Right. He's a tiny doll.
He's a tiny doll man. Just kick him. Chucky's better than mummies, though. I think we can all agree with that.
Yeah. Chucky has some personality to him.
Yes.
Mummies, I think maybe that's the thing. Mummies lack personality.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
They don't have a thing. I mean, curse. But, you know, a curse is so ethereal. It's just, it's out there. Oh, I guess I have bad luck?
I think the curse is just the mummy that killed you.
Oh, is that it?
I think so.
That's the mummy's curse? Is the mummy
If the mummy ever catches up with you, it'll kill you. All right, I'll just run away every time I see him. Because he shuffles slowly.
That's the mummy's curse?
I think it is.
Oh. All
right, mummy versus zombie.
They're basically the same thing.
I know they are.
One mummy
versus one zombie.
Versus one zombie? The mummy wins.
The scary thing about zombies, though, is that they can gang up on you.
Right.
And that they might be relatives of yours, which is psychologically terrifying.
Mm-hmm. They resemble people.
Yes. Yeah, they're people, basically. They were people.
The loss of humanity, absolutely.
Right.
Friendly fire.
Yeah, he's fine. Yeah, he's chicken. He'll be fine.
Hi, Colin. Yes, that Warcraft movie does look terrible.
There's a Warcraft movie?
They're making a full-length Warcraft movie.
Realistic-looking humans, because they're humans, and...
Oh, so it's animated.
And no. I mean, live-action people, but the orcs, they kind of look like straight out of the video game, cartoony.
Oh.
They're proportioned, like, all goofy.
Is this like a big theatrical release?
Yep.
I haven't even heard of
Legendary and Universal Pictures.
Who's directing? Some nobody?
Let me
Is it Stephen Sommers, the director of The Mummy with Brendan Fraser? Because that wouldn't surprise me. That sounds like a movie he would make.
What it looks like is if I were a fan of the World of Warcraft, it looks like a movie.
Oh,
Duncan Jones.
Duncan Jones. That name sounds familiar.
Moon.
Oh, no. Moon is a great movie.
He's getting paid. That's cool.
I guess.
He's getting paid.
All right. I haven't seen the trailer, so I can't really comment, I guess. But
Moon was great.
Moon is a fantastic movie.
Moon is a great little sci-fi movie. Oh, look at your guys breathe.
You know what else is a fantastic movie?
What?
This little thing I just saw called The Shawshank Redemption.
Yeah!
Have you heard of it? Have you heard of that film?
How awesome, Jay, is The Shawshank Redemption?
It's a great movie.
Great
movie. It's a great movie that I knew was going to be a great movie, which is why I wasn't so, like, I hadn't seen the movie, but I had basically seen the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Just through pop culture osmosis.
Of course.
But it's a testament to how good the movie is that...
You didn't care.
Well, that I didn't care what.
That you knew what was going
to
happen.
Yeah, exactly. Like, the writing and the performances especially are so strong. Like, even when it got to the ending, when there's the big reveal of what Tim Robbins has been up to, which I already knew, it was still incredibly satisfying.
Mm-hmm.
And even the voiceover, like, I don't like voiceover narration in too many movies, but it works so great in that. Because Tim Robbins is basically the main character, but it's through the point of view of the Morgan Freeman character. Like, it's great.
Red?
Red, yeah.
Red.
When it started, the cinematography reminded me a lot of what?
I shit you not, Alex Kurtzman is making a Mummy movie. What? Hold on.
Alex Kurtzman.
The guy who did,
is that the...
The guy who did Shawshank.
Shawshank? No, that's Frank Darabont. Yeah. Shawshank Redemption. Did Alex Kurtzman write the Walking Dead comic?
No, that
Kurtzman
was...
wrote a Walking Dead comic.
Kirkman.
Oh, Alex Kurtzman from Kurtzman and Orky.
Yeah.
Fuck that asshole.
I'm so sorry.
That's terrible news.
I was thinking of Darabont, by the way.
Okay.
So, I was like, oh, that must be the Darabont.
Yeah, Walking Dead, you think of... Yeah. I understand the confusion.
Oh, my God, I'm so sorry.
Oh, God.
I'm so sorry, Frank Darabont.
No, you're not.
I am.
You knew it.
I didn't. I didn't know what I was doing.
Yeah, the look of The Shawshank Redemption reminded me a lot of a Coen Brothers movie, which made sense because then I found out the cinematographer is Roger Deakins, who's done a lot of their movies.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Sure, I can see that.
So yes, now I can say I've seen The Shawshank Redemption.
Mm-hmm.
I can say it's great.
So I bet you got busy living.
I got busy living.
And you didn't get busy.
I did not get busy dying.
Oh, that's great. Congratulations.
Thank you. I consider this a big accomplishment.
Now, is.
Now people don't have to annoy me with, you've never seen The Shawshank Redemption?
It's one of those things, though, that where now that you've seen it, you understand why we were all confused.
I understood before. That's the thing. I know it's a great movie without seeing it, because I know everything about it, because everybody told me everything about it.
Right.
It's like somebody continually turning down $1 million. What?
No, I will say.
I don't need that right now.
I will say there.
I'm sure it's fine. $1 million.
As far as great movies go, though, it's not one that like I connected with personally all that much. It's a little schmaltzier than. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a good kind of schmaltz. It's not bad. But the day before that, I had rewatched Dog Day Afternoon.
Oh, okay.
With Al Pacino.
Sure.
Which, that's my type of movie, as far as, like, classics go, where it just feels so grounded and real.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the kind of thing that I am interested in more than sort of heightened emotion schmaltz. So, I understand it's a great movie. I liked it a lot.
Just like human misery.
No. It's not human misery. Actually, Dog Day Afternoon kind of ends pretty miserable, but it's not just that. It's just the tone of, like, where things are more grounded and realistic is more my kind of thing.
Oh God, there was a thing blocking me.
But that's not to take away from how great Shawshank Redemption is.
Right, a different kind.
It's a great movie. Everyone's going to say Jay hates Shawshank Redemption. But
they're saying it already.
Of course. Nah, just great performances all around. Clancy Brown,
mm-hmm.
William Sadler, Grim Reaper from Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey, of course, in that movie. He's one of the inmates with the slight stutter.
Yeah.
Is he?
Yeah. You might not recognize him because he's not wearing pancake makeup and black under his eyes.
That's the only way I would recognize him. Is if he is playing that one character. The one character of that.
He's the main bad guy in Die Hard 2. William Sadler's great.
He's been around.
Is he?
He's the president in Iron Man 3.
The president or the vice president?
The vice president is Miguel Ferrer.
That's right.
The president is William Sadler.
Oh yeah. Hmm? It's so, you know what, him with hair.
He's like one of those guys. Yep. You're like, "Oh, it's that guy."
Him now that you say that, I can picture what he looks like without looking like a Grim Reaper.
He's in The Mist, which is also Frank Darabont, so that's not surprising. Oh, I love William Sadler. He's great.
Well,
he's the lead. I don't know if he plays the lead very often, but he's the lead in the Tales from the Crypt film Demon Knight. He's very good in that.
Is he the lead?
Yeah, he's the lead. Well, he starts as the lead, and then Jada Pinkett Smith kind of takes over as the lead.
Yeah.
But he starts the movie as the lead.
I think that was Billy Zane.
He's the bad guy. Oh man, he's chewing the scenery in that movie. It's so great.
I mean, in every movie, Billy.
Well, especially that movie.
That's Billy Zane. The Zane.
Yeah.
That's what.
Don't mess with my friend Billy Zane. He's a cool dude. It's from Zoolander.
It's been a while since I've seen it.
No.
Billy Zane is amazing. Only because one of the few movies we have going on.
Oh, God. I don't think I've ever seen The Phantom.
We have to see The Phantom.
Oh, man.
I'm sure it's great.
Purple spandex. That's what you did with your superhero costumes back then.
You needed spandex, so we'll make spandex. That was part of the the early years of superhero movies.
The awkward years, yeah.
The Phantom. The Shadow.
The Shadow.
With Alec Baldwin.
Was that... That was post-Batman.
The Shadow?
Post Tim Burton Batman, so there's really no excuse.
Well, Tim Burton Batman, come on, is a little cheese.
Sure, but I mean the costume's great. It's not just like cheap spandex.
Sure. The Phantom and the Shadow have blended in my head to make Darkman. Yes.
Well, Darkman's great though.
Yeah.
Darkman is great. In its own right.
Yeah. Have you guys talked about Ash vs. Evil Dead?
I haven't seen episode 2 yet.
Oh, I watched episode 2.
Yeah.
It's great. I was worried. The show is great, by the way.
Of course.
If anyone was wondering what I thought of it. It's great.
We're all surprised to hear this from you.
Yeah.
They're not going to stop you from talking about Ash vs. the Evil Dead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nobody
My concern was, though, after because the first episode Sam Raimi directed, and I was worried there'd be, like, a pretty dramatic downgrade in quality as far as like the visuals, because he's such a visual filmmaker.
Yeah,
the camera's constantly doing weird shit.
Mm-hmm.
I love that scene on the first episode where it's lit solely by the flashlight spinning on the ground.
Yes.
That's like classic Evil Dead Sam Raimi stuff.
Yep.
So I was concerned about that like maybe the other episodes would look cheaper or be more like generic looking, but that second episode it lives up to the first one.
See, like I was really excited to have him hand over the reins to someone else.
I wouldn't say I was excited. I was hesitant. I was very hesitant.
I love Evil Dead, and I worried after like I love the first episode. Rich and I already talked about this. Love the first episode. Putting that out there because I know you're already typing. You're already typing. Jack hates Evil Dead. Love Evil Dead, but the first episode was a little reference-y.
I would say it was just the right amount.
It was enough that it got me worried about the rest of it.
Okay.
And so then, like, handing off the reins to another director meant we might get a fresher take. And I'm excited about that. I'm excited about watching
There's one pretty big reference to Evil Dead 2 in the second episode, but that's about it. Mm-hmm. The majority of the episode is just the most awkward dinner scene ever. It's so great.
Oh, good.
So you have Stars now, right? You can watch.
I do.
Is it like on demand or something?
It is.
Stars? So you can watch it.
It's also on demand.
You gotta watch it.
I'm gonna watch it. I've been watching other things while working, and so that has been my priority, is finishing my binge.
Okay.
Binge watching far, like, not as good a shows. Like, I should be watching Ash vs. Evil Dead, but I want to, like...
Ash vs. Evil Dead is, like, pure bliss.
Yeah.
It's not the best show ever, but it feels like it. I was so... As you're watching it, you're like, this is the greatest thing ever. Even though you know in the back of your mind it isn't. It's just so... I was so relieved more than anything that it was so great. Because it could have so... Like, you know, all this time has passed. Yeah. Like, it could have not worked at all, but they just nail it. Mm-hmm. And that's... I mean, Evil Dead 2 is, like, one of the most important movies to me. So the fact that they don't fuck it up is great.
Yeah.
And not just that it's like new Evil Dead, but the fact that it's like Bruce Campbell, Sam Raimi, Rob Tappert, all the original people, even the guy who did the music, Joe LaDuca. Mm-hmm. Like, and it's not like an exact copy of the score from Evil Dead 2, but it has that same sort of feel. Like, the fact that all those guys have been working together since they were like kids is so great that they're still doing it.
Oh, yeah.
And it's still good.
And like, they got the tone right.
Yeah.
Of course, they understand what makes it great because they made it in the first place.
But that doesn't necessarily mean anything. George Lucas. I'd say that's the exception, not the rule, as far as like a creator coming back and getting it right. George Miller and Sam Raimi.
That's it. The only two ever. Yeah.
Nah, I'd say Sylvester Stallone did it twice.
Oh, that's right.
Rocky and Rambo. He came back with both of them, and they both worked.
Rocky Balboa. That's a good movie.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, you know, Rocky Balboa is a good movie. It, of course, is nothing but a retread of Rocky.
Right.
But it's a good movie. But I can't tell, because I have such a soft spot for Rocky.
Oh, sure.
Fuck it, all those movies I love.
Yeah.
And so there's no way I can even be a little bit objective. Even if, for Creed, which looks good.
Oh, I think that looks so good.
Even if it's crap, I'm going to love it because it's another Rocky movie.
Yeah, well, that's interesting because it's not... Like, all the other movies were written by Stallone. It was, like, his project. And the interesting thing about that whole series is the way that each one sort of reflects where he was in his life and career at the time.
Yeah.
And this new one, someone came to him with it. It wasn't his project. He didn't write it. It's, I don't know the director's name, but he did a movie called Fruitvale Station with Michael B. Jordan, who plays Creed in the movie. And he just grew up a fan of the Rocky movie, so he's like, hey, I want to do this Rocky thing. And he got Stallone on board. So it's a little bit of a different perspective.
Interesting. That's exciting.
I'm scared Rocky's gonna die in it. I think he might die in it. There's stuff in the trailer about him being sick.
Rocky's had a good long life.
I know. Oh no, it'll be completely appropriate and satisfying if he dies in it. I get it, but it'll still make me sad.
Rocky will live on forever in our hearts.
Oh sure.
That's the moral of the story.
Mm-hmm. But I love the idea of him now being Mickey, basically. Yeah. Like I think that's neat. As long as this is the last one.
Nope. Creed 7.
Rocky Balboa would have worked as the final one, but now this doing like a passing of the baton thing, like that works. And if they make another Creed movie, but don't have Rocky in it. You know, let Rocky be done after this.
Not if he dies.
If he dies, then he won't be in it unless he's a force ghost.
In Creed 2, that's what's going to happen. Rocky has to train Creed again as a ghost. It's actually a combination movie. It's Creed 2, Ouija 2.
Okay. No, maybe they'll bring back the robot from Rocky 4, and Rocky's spirit will now be in the robot. That would be great.
Okay. Rich is going to watch the Preacher trailer now.
Full screen. The music's right. Get out of there, kid! Who are you? You're not anybody! This doesn't seem much like the comic book.
Problem is your daddy's a big fella. He's got far back. Things will escalate. That's what these things do. They escalate.
fuck is that? Who the fuck is that kid? Who the fuck is that purple guy? I don't think this has anything to do with the comic book. I don't know. I don't know. They got the music right.
Okay.
Well, there you go.
Hey, I don't care about you. There you go. So.
No, I don't see a Saint of Killers. I don't see.
No, it's just a trailer.
I know.
I would be more concerned with the trailer if it's capturing the tone more so than specifics.
Mm.
And I can't say if that does or not, but.
Yeah. AMC.
Are you saying it doesn't seem to have the tone of the comics?
Humor runs throughout Preacher.
Mm. Humor?
Humor. Yeah, dark, very dark humor.
Okay, that looks like The Walking Dead or something.
Yeah.
Just like a dour, boring thing.
Hey, what's the most popular show on AMC right now?
It's so, AMC, I guess. So funny. Maybe they're just trying to make another Walking Dead. They've already made another Walking Dead. Now they're making another Walking Dead.
That's true. Have you seen any of that? No, that's right. You haven't watched, like, regular Walking Dead.
I haven't watched regular Walking Dead. I don't care about lesser Walking Dead. GoBot Walking Dead. I don't care.
Walking Dead prequel.
The Walking
Dead. Is it a prequel?
The Fear of the Walking Dead? Yeah.
No.
That's the, like, how it started or something.
Oh, God. I don't care.
I saw that. I didn't care. I obviously didn't care. I just watched it. The show's not necessarily for people who liked the comic book.
You would think they would go for that, though.
You know, you need something there for the core audience, but also, you know, it was a cult comic book, which means not a lot of people read it.
Yeah.
And they probably want more people to watch the show.
I don't think it was a cult comic book. It was a pretty popular comic book at the time.
The trailer clearly said cult comic book,
Rich.
Who
am I going to trust? You a fan of the comic book or a television network?
That's trying to advertise the show.
That's trying to advertise the television program.
And we'll say anything to advertise the program.
You know why they say cult comic book? Because that's The Walking Dead, right?
That wasn't a big
comic book, right?
It was an indie comic, yeah.
So that's a cult comic. So now, like, here's another cult comic.
I think technically Preacher is a cult comic.
No. I don't think you understand what cult means.
Does it have a rabid fan base?
It has a small and loyal fan base.
It had a large fan base. It was a pretty big comic book.
But it's not like Spider-Man. Right? Yeah. It's not like a big,
it
like a mainstream.
It only ran so long, it told its story, and then it was done.
Mm.
But at the time, it wasn't like a secret, what's this Preacher thing?
Sure, but I'm assuming it wasn't like a big juggernaut, like a Superman or Batman comic.
Oh, not even close.
I would imagine, so.
It was published by Vertigo, so not one of the majors.
Yeah.
That's DC Comics.
And in
Vertigo? Vertigo is their non-superhero kind of arty stuff.
Right.
Did DC always own Vertigo?
Yes.
Oh.
I'm trying to see if they have any, like, sales numbers or, you know, something like that. Get out of here. Okay, there we go. I found my way.
Warning, ammunition critical. Oh no, you're in the future war room.
So many boxes.
Look at all those boxes.
Yes. Yes, that's true.
Bill LaHecka says he thinks it's cute how you're defending Preacher's pop culture reach.
I'm just saying, within comic book circles, it was a pretty big title. It wasn't a cult comic book. Anything comic book is cult as far as the rest of the world is concerned.
Exactly.
But as far as comics are concerned, Preacher was not cult.
You know, I was in comic shops at that time. I never heard of Preacher.
You also hate Farscape.
Yes. Farscape is also a smaller show, not a big show. But, you know, I would say Preacher is similar to that, not big.
Preacher had hype. Preacher had hype at the time it came out, Jack. You're just wrong about
it. Have you ever heard of Preacher before?
I've heard of Preacher.
Oh, okay. Jay heard of
it. But I've heard of Preacher from comic book nerds.
Oh, from Rich.
Actually, no. I mean, I've heard Rich talk about it, but I had heard about it from someone else before that. But yeah, comic book nerds.
Comic book nerds, yeah.
So I don't care either way.
That's the real point. It doesn't
matter. Oh, fuck.
It just doesn't matter.
Swamp could Shawshank Redemption be considered a cult movie? Because it was a bomb when it came out.
Was it a bomb?
Not like a horrible flop, but yeah. It didn't make a whole lot of money.
I don't know. That's
and then it gained like a huge audience on video, which is often called a cult classic. Yeah. A movie like that.
I don't, you know, like there's a gray area.
That's a cult classic for dads.
Like also that is probably showing somewhere on cable television every second of every day.
Well, that's yeah, I was reading about it and that's sort of how it gained an audience and how it became as popular as it is
TBS.
TBS or TNT, one of those two, like bought the rights to play it for super cheap, so they would play it all the time.
Right.
So it's always on, and that's how a lot of people have seen it. And now people think of it as this like classic movie, so I don't think they even realize that it wasn't like a big hit when it came out.
I'm getting a little motion sick. Watching I'm gonna have to go like this. I'm gonna have to not look at it for a little bit.
Well, do you want to play something?
No.
No.
I said no. Damn it. Star Wars April.
BB-8 in general is pretty neat, as far as the design goes, and the fact that it's a practical robot.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that thing is awesome.
Collecting Data says that they had a Yoda toy that was a Magic 8-Ball.
Okay.
That makes sense.
Yeah, you want to ask... If you want to get your fortune from anyone, you want it to be Yoda.
He does have fortune cookie wisdom. I mean, Yoda's just really, honestly, completely useless. Try or try not! Helpful this advice is not!
Hindsight is key to knowledge. Yes. Yeah.
Come back later and I'll finish trading you. Oh, wait, never mind. I'm dead.
You don't need to use a lightsaber. Oh, wait, you need to use a lightsaber. Fuck. I'm sorry. Oh, I didn't know you were getting a lightsaber fight. BB-8 is... What are you talking about? BB-8's great. Little ball robot.
I like BB-8.
I like
it. It reminds me a lot of classic Star Wars movie magic.
Yep.
If it was just a completely CG thing, then maybe I would feel different, but knowing that it's a practical robot... I mean, I'm sure it's CG in certain parts of the movie, but there is a practical functioning robot that they built for the movie, I think is...
Oh, see, I didn't even think beyond that. It's just a fun robot design.
Yeah, it is.
I don't give no fucks
The fact
about
that he's
CG.
Practical makes it a dozen times cooler.
Yes, I agree.
What do you know? I
know. What do you know?
You know I know.
You don't
nothing.
Know shit about fuck.
That's really true. I know. I don't care about CG like you guys do. But I just think it's a neat design. Little ball robot. Weep weep.
That was actually my biggest problem with the pilot episode of Ash vs. Evil Dead.
Yeah.
Some of the sketchy CG.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
The second episode irons that out a lot, which makes me wonder, because Sam Raimi in general has a lot of, like, awkward, bad CG in his movies.
Uh-huh.
So I think it might just be Sam Raimi, because he didn't direct the second episode, and it's integrated a lot more naturally. There's a couple sequences in Drag Me to Hell, and I like that movie a lot, but some of the CG, you're like, oh, really?
I think Sam Raimi just doesn't care?
I just think maybe he doesn't know how to incorporate it naturally. I don't know. Same with those Spider-Man movies. Like, I love the Sam Raimi Spider-Man, but every time he jumps, it's like, now he's a cartoon. It's like such a sharp contrast.
Yeah. Yeah, but there's, you know, there's not a lot of better ways to do that.
Well, I always said that, like, if you're going to do a proper Spider-Man movie, just have the whole thing be animated. And then you don't run into that problem.
Sure.
Where when he starts flipping around and it looks completely unnatural.
People don't want that.
I know. I understand that.
Do you?
I do.
Do you? Great.
Well, Tree Rat Creations, that's a different problem altogether. It says, I was watching a movie in a movie theater the other day, and I noticed something that needs to change. Right now it says, silence your cell phones. And they're saying that people should turn off their cell phones because he's sick of seeing the bright screens
people
texting.
Well, that's just assholes that are taking their phone out when they shouldn't be.
Why are you taking your phone out in a movie theater? It's a ridiculous thing.
Sporting events. I've seen, like, Ben baseball games here, just like this. They're not watching the game at all.
Sure. Oh, no.
Well, but that's, you're outside, there's the sun, like in a dark movie theater, and there's this bright light. That's obnoxious.
Yeah, but I mean, it's like, why are you spending a ticket to get in?
Sure, sure. Right. I understand.
Major league cheap seats in a major league game are like $25.
Yeah, that's a different problem, though. I understand what you mean, but that's different than in a movie theater where everything's dark.
Right.
And then that light is so distracting.
Like them looking at their phone during a baseball game does not affect your viewing of the game.
Right. Was that a coffee burp?
It was like a little coffee burp, and it's like, oh, that might have been something more.
Ugh.
Doom!
Really? It affects you that much, huh?
It really does.
Wow.
It really does. And it's older first-person shooters more than more modern ones, and I don't know.
For the fun ones.
Huh?
So the fun ones.
Can't you, if you're just looking down like this?
I see the movement.
In the peripheral about
the
you?
The peripheral, in the movement in the peripheral.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I'll just go like this.
You got a problem.
What do you want me to do instead? What am I doing instead?
I got a problem.
You got a problem.
I can't go on roller coasters. My tummy hurts. I know it's a game extreme. The problem is not, it's with Doom. The problem is exactly with Doom. Yeah, Rich has seen Dredd, right? You've watched Dredd.
Oh, you have watched Dredd.
Yeah.
Jay has seen Shawshank. Rich has seen Dredd. The world.
Now what are we going to do with our lives? Did you like Dredd?
Yeah.
Okay. I knew you would.
It's that character.
Yeah.
It's all that character.
Oh, that's exactly,
completely uncompromising.
The fact
and that's
that they,
wonderful.
That they nailed that, yeah, and did it right.
He doesn't soften.
Never takes off his helmet.
Yep.
Yeah.
I love that there's that one moment early on with the psychic, his partner, when she's like, I see something behind, you know, his whatever. I don't remember exactly what she says, but hinting that there's more to him, and then it's just never brought up again.
Yep.
I think that's great.
Where am I lost? Where am I supposed to go here?
Dredd is perfect. It's so perfect that it didn't make money, and it won't have a sequel.
Yep.
No matter how much you want it, Internet.
I know Carl Urban wants to do one.
Of course.
But no, it wasn't a big hit.
Nope. Not going to happen.
Did you hear Leatherface died?
I did.
That made me really sad.
I heard Leatherface died because you tweeted about it.
Oh, okay.
That's how you feel about it.
Guy.
So it was the guy that played Leatherface.
Gunnar Hansen, who played Leatherface in the first movie.
Okay.
I got to meet him 12, 15 years ago.
Okay.
I used to work at this like Best Buy type place. It's now out of business, but they would occasionally do signings. And so he was there signing it was around Halloween time, and they just recently released Texas Chainsaw Massacre on DVD. So he was there signing that.
Oh, nice.
I was working that day and got to hang out with him a little bit backstage, and just like it's funny because he's Leatherface, this like, you know, inbred cannibal monster, savage, but he was like the nicest, like most like soft spoken, pleasant man.
Who'd think he wouldn't be a monster in real life?
Sure, but just like it's funny with all those, like Robert Englund too. He's just like this super intelligent, really nice guy. And they just play these creatures.
Well, it's not even about the creature, like the intensity of Leatherface.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
like,
exactly.
You would almost expect him to be, like, almost a dude bro. You know?
Right.
Like, yeah, let's do this.
Well, that's the guy that plays Leatherface in the remake. He's, like, this big, he looks like a wrestler or something, like this heavy metal wrestler guy.
Sure. But
no,
sure.
He's just, he looks like Santa Claus, Gunnar Hansen. And I knew, like everyone, of course, I knew was going to be asking him about Texas Chainsaw Massacre, so I made a point of bringing up another film he did called Hollywood Chainsaw Hookers that he's in.
So he's in two
from the director of Alienator. I think that's why he's in Hollywood Chainsaw Hookers, because it's the Chainsaw connection. And that's the thing, is like, that's an iconic role, Leatherface.
Yeah.
I was very sad to hear about him passing in roles where he actually had lines. Not really good actor. But a very nice man. And I was very it's, and also it's more like, because Wes Craven just passed, and just like, we're at that age now where these like people that were in these things that we grew up with and helped sort of inform our tastes, like they're you know, passing away with more frequency now, and that makes me sad.
Yeah, it's, you know what, it's time for the next generation.
Yeah, well, I was thinking about that too, like, there, when people talk about like the horror icon characters, there's like the 30s and 40s, the Universal monsters.
Sure, sure.
And then like in the 70s and the 80s, there's Leatherface, Jason, you know, Freddy.
Freddy, of course.
What, there's no real modern equivalent of that. Like, that hasn't happened since then.
Well, the modern horror equivalent started with the like the found footage, right?
But not like characters I'm talking about.
Oh,
like,
oh,
I mean, there's
sure,
been
sure.
different trends sure. and different like
characters.
Yeah, like the closest
What's
would maybe be Jigsaw from the Saw movies, but there's oh, not like a sure. group of, sure. you know, that hasn't really happened since that period.
Is it time for the resurgence?
Maybe. I don't know if that works anymore, though. I think that scene is sort of a campy,
old...
outdated thing. Yeah, they reboot the old ones, and they suck. And then they don't get sequels, and they don't live on anyway.
Well, right. Do you think if they made new ones, wouldn't they just suck too?
Not necessarily.
No. R. Miller has a good one. What about Japanese ghost girls?
I guess, but that's not
that's
like
a thing.
I don't know. These are trends, you know. Like, there's the found footage movies. There's the Japanese
ghost
movies.
Well, no, like
movies,
The Ring. The Ring was very influential.
Sure. But when you think of, like, iconic horror characters, you don't think of the little girl with the black hair.
I kind of do.
Really?
The little girl with the black hair?
Yeah,
If you see the little girl with the black hair, you know exactly what
That's true.
You know.
That's true.
I would argue that that is an iconic horror character.
Okay. Maybe there needs to be more distance from it to look back on
sure.
and reflect. I don't
well,
know.
Well, there isn't just one, though, dark-haired ghost.
Oh, yeah,
Japanese
there's plenty. There's The Grudge, too.
Yeah.
That same type of character.
Whoa.
Probably plenty of other ones that I've never seen or
so
heard
it's,
of.
So it's not an iconic character, though it is a kind of an iconic
visual,
character type.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
That's true. There's a trend, or not a trend, but a phrase I heard recently, because there is sort of a new era of horror filmmakers, these people that are doing these lower, like, independent horror films, people like Adam Wingard, who did You're Next and The Guest, and Ty West, who's done, like, The Innkeepers and House of the Devil.
Sure.
So these sort of, like, minimalist independent horror films, and they the certain section of, like, horror journalists have labeled this new generation of horror filmmakers, they're calling it Death Wave. Like, that's the movement, you know? Like, you have the French New Wave. So they're calling them Death Wave, and they're all like, what the fuck is that? Don't call us that. Like, that sucks. Because it's not a wave. It's just different horror filmmakers making movies. It's not like there's a unifying thing between all of them.
I was just going to ask, what's the unifying
there
thing?
There isn't.
Death Wave? Oh.
So it's like the stupidest label. Death Wave.
Death Wave is people who made horror movies in this year?
Like. Yeah.
But their horror movies are different.
Yeah, there's nothing to connect any of them.
That's a wave, man. It's not connected at all. Or wait.
Yeah.
Just don't think about it too much.
So a bunch of them are like, fuck that. Don't call us that.
That's great.
Mm-hmm. Death Wave. And it's a shitty name anyway. Even if there was some sort of movement, Death Wave just sounds dumb.
Death Wave sounds like a movie I want to watch.
I would watch a movie called Death Wave.
Is that
yeah.
like a surfing horror movie?
Ooh.
Death Wave. A killer wave?
It's a maybe not a movie. That'd be a good, like, Tales from the Crypt episode. A killer wave.
Like the wave just crests and it just keeps spinning you over
yeah.
and over.
Yeah.
Ah.
Another surfer died. What?
It's the wave, man. It's trying to kill us.
No,
dude.
We should just not go in the water.
Waves can't think.
The wave is possessed by the ghost of that girl we killed 5 years ago.
That we drowned in this very
In this ocean.
But dude, the big surf competition is this weekend.
We have to go in the water. We have to compete.
It practically writes itself.
It's already written. We just did it.
We just made a movie.
It happened. You're welcome. Gramdolph, I know you're getting spooked, and it's okay. It's okay to be spooked by Death Wave. Just let it crash over you.
That was good.
Pretty happy with that.
Is that the joke's crescendo?
Nice.
If I didn't stumble on my words, it
would yeah. Be nice. Listen, I was trying.
Otherwise,
to,
it was merely okay.
I was trying to.
Death Wave.
Death Wave.
It's tubular. What? I'm not saying that.
That's the end of the trailer. Is the voiceover guy that. Saying, I'm not saying that.
Have you ever seen the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre?
Ages ago. I
R2 hasn't seen it. R2 just shook his head.
You know, I want to say everybody's seen it. I have no... The only memory I have is, like, I know that scene where they pick up the girl in the beginning and she goes crazy in the back of the van.
That's the remake.
Oh, fuck.
That's the remake?
In the original, they pick up a hitchhiker as a dude. In the remake, they pick up a woman, and she pulls a gun out of her vagina and blows her head off. Because that's edgy.
Oh my god. It's been so long.
Okay.
I you know what? I might as well just say no.
It's been long enough where even if you had, you don't remember.
Exactly. The answer is I have seen it, but I have no recollection of it.
Oh, it's so great. I'd say not just a great horror movie. I would say it's a great movie. It's a it's a masterclass in DIY filmmaking. Like, it's such a well constructed, well shot movie. Mm-hmm. The sound design is amazing.
I believe you.
It's so great, and there's next to no gore. That's the thing people always think of it as being this like violent, disgusting movie.
Yeah,
there's hardly any blood in it.
That's great.
It's all in your brain.
All the blood is in your brain?
It's true.
That's yeah.
I mean, in more ways than
your
one,
brain
it's true.
Is a terrible place. Yeah.
Why was the gun in her vagina? Because where else was she going to keep it? She was wearing tight pants.
No, she's wearing like a sundress.
Oh,
one
okay.
thing I will give that remake, because it's not great. one of the most beautifully shot dumb slasher movies ever made. Every shot in that movie looks like it could be a framed image.
Hmm.
It's a really good-looking movie.
There you go. Ooh, I like that Tyrant said. Death Wave versus Vagina Gun. You can't call it Vagina Gun. You gotta call it Pussy Gun.
You can't put that on the poster, Jack.
Of course you can. No. Put a cat on there. It's fun.
Oh, okay.
Pussy Gun.
You don't need posters anymore. It's direct-to-video.
That's true. That's true.
You can call a movie whatever you want now.
It has no ring to it. I think it would
turn off a large portion of the audience too.
It has a better ring than Vagina Gun.
It still has a terrible ring to it.
Okay.
So, at the end of the day, you still have a terrible name.
We need a better name then. Oh my god, Vagina Mite.
Vagina Mite? Like Dolomite?
Like dynamite in your vagina.
Okay.
Vagina Mite. Thank you, General Zukov. Vagina Mite. That's a great name for our Vagina Gun movie.
Something is not triggering what it should be. I can't get, I'm like trapped.
Oh.
Vagina Mite.
I like it all. I'm sorry, Rich.
Am I experiencing a glitch? There should be a thing that comes up there. A walkway, but there's no walkway.
I know
nothing. I understand.
About
I understand
the Doom universe.
I know you know nothing about good games.
I know nothing about good games. I only know things about bad games.
Did you ever see the Doom movie with The Rock?
I saw the sequence
where they did it in the first person.
The first person, yeah.
It's the only thing anybody has ever seen from that movie.
Right. I saw it in the theater because we went to see something else. It was like Halloween time.
Mm-hmm.
And whatever we were going to see, I don't remember what else came out that year, was sold out. So we're like, well, we're here. It's kind of horror related. So we'll go see Doom. And it was just like the dumbest thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the only thing I remember is that first person. I don't remember anything about the rest of the movie.
Yep. Really enjoy the Super Smash Brothers. Because then Mario could beat up Link. It's awesome.
Who would win a fight?
Mario.
Mario would Link win. Yeah,
usually Mario.
I don't want to watch them fight. They're both good guys.
It's true. It's true. Mario could fight Ganon.
Who's Ganon?
He's the bad guy in the Zelda.
Oh. I wasn't a big Zelda kid.
You weren't a big...
No, I never played Zelda much. I played Mario.
Ah, okay. Well, Link could beat up Bowser.
Okay.
That's something...
I will accept that.
How you doing, Rich?
I'm about done with doing.
You done? Okay. Backup game is Fatal with the Steam controller.
All right. That sounds fine.
Great.
I'm probably going to head out.
Jay's going to head out.
I was originally just going to tell everybody that I saw Shawshank Redemption, but then I hung out for a little bit more, so.
Hey, we appreciate that.
So what you're saying is that the stream is effectively over.
That's not true. Is everyone going to leave when I leave? That'd be very rude.
No, I guess my guess is we will get a drop, but not everyone will leave.
Okay.
A slight drop. Are you in big picture mode? You gotta be in big picture mode.
For fuck's sake.
What is this big picture mode?
It is so Steam is the digital service in which you get games.
Right.
Big picture mode is a Steam operating system.
It takes over your computer.
Okay.
It takes over your computer like this.
And everything's like ridiculously large and you can't alt tab out easily.
Mm.
It was designed so you could navigate all of Steam using
a controller. It's made so a lazy retard can do everything with a controller.
Okay.
Sorry.
I understand.
Yeah. Do you?
I do.
Rich.
What? I call it like I see it, Jack.
Yeah.
I know you don't appreciate that.
I know. I know. I appreciate you calling it like you see it. Some language things that
call it like you see
that
it.
That I don't appreciate. I think I'm gonna go with Jay.
This is the perfect time to leave. the statements by Rich Evans are not endorsed by Red Letter Media or any of its affiliates.
Or anyone.
Except for maybe Donald Trump.
Oh, sick burn. That's a sick burn.
Hashtag boycott SNL.
What?
Hashtag boycott SNL.
Oh, yeah.
People were going to boycott it because he hosted it.
Oh, that's true. And then they got their highest ratings.
And they got their highest ratings, like even though I'm sure it was horribly unfunny.
Sure.
Because why would it be any different than any other episode?
Right. Yep. But thanks for hashtagging it. You hashtag the chat. It doesn't do us any good if you hashtag the chat. Boycott SNL.
Yeah, you could. I guess you could type that in the chat. It just won't. It doesn't do anything for anybody.
It won't trend more on Twitter if you hashtag in the chat.
Right.
So.
Or will it?
Yes.
I don't know how them Twitters work.
That's exactly how it works.
Oh. I thought you just hashtag something anywhere and anyone can see it.
What? What?
Hashtag.
Hashtag.
Hashtag bye.
Bye, Jay. Goodbye.
Bye, Jay.
Bye, everyone.
Shawshank's great.
Goodbye, humor. Society has murdered you in your blind pursuit of mindless political correctness.
No, it's not a political correctness.
Fuck thing. Context! Fuck context!
I don't think it's a political correctness thing. It's a decency thing.
Things mean the same in every context and setting!
Definitions can never change.
All right, you're playing for a bit.
No, I'm not playing.
Oh, you're playing for. I'm gamed out.
Huh?
I'm gamed out.
Then we'll just call it.
Really? After teasing them with FTL?
Huh?
After teasing them with FTL?
Actually, that makes me want to call it more.
Because I've been gaming, you know, fast paced Doom for a bit. You know, I want a break. I need a break.
Okay. Yeah, no, and I'm still like I'm still very.
You're still motion sick?
I'm feeling sick.
All right.
I'm feeling sick. All
right. I'll tell you what.
What?
I will promise the chat a full night of FTL. It'll be Sunday.
Okay.
We'll do a full night of FTL.
Sure.
And we'll have names and everything, and we'll bust out the Steam controller for it.
Sure. Okay. Great.
All right. I guess that's it. All right.